According to Buddhism and the believer and the tradition, when you read sutra and all that, you have to put on incense, flower, you know, and bow to the sutra first and thank all the Buddhas and Bodhisattva in 10 directions, all respectfully, before you read it, okay? And then you cover the sutra also with silk or, you know, beautiful cloth, and I just make it more popular. Yeah, more easy, simple. And I apologize to all the Buddha. I say, if I done something wrong, according to the tradition, my heart is full of respect. It's just that I cannot always do that. So please, all the sin, whatever I've done wrong, is all on me. At least other people, they hear the names of the Buddha, according to the sutta, they will get benefit. Yes. Hello. No need to. Oh my trouble. I got this for the video team, cutting team. Yeah, later, okay? Share, huh? That's all I had. The fruit. Yeah, I'm losing some weight, I think, or maybe the trousers is too big. Yeah, okay. How's everybody? Good, yeah? Still very little men, huh? Only woman, huh? They always say, let me go, honey. And then all the men had to stay home. Yeah? Washing dishes, watching babies. And all the women come here and sit long time. Right? Huh? Nimmer nui heise. How come your husband let you go? Sha jiao, huh? Huh? 你们先生没讲什么啊? Your husband don't say anything? No? No husband? What? 听不懂啊? Okay. Because always a lot of women came. Nah? Men very little. Why? You kung fu him or something? Why is so quiet today? Huh? It's not fun. Okay. I don't have too many stories anymore from this book. We have some story about some nuns, and a story about somebody who making a lot of offering and has good merit. Which one you like to hear? Story of the nuns, follow the Buddha, or the story of another offering? None?
Yes.
Good. Let's do that. I don't have monk story for you guys to. Okay. Yeah. Very good. Well, you like to hear monk story? Do you men? Huh? You men would like to hear monk story? Yes?
Josh.
Don't have. Sorry. Got you. Oh, I have to have my magic. Today I use this, wet towel, the ready-made wet towel to clean it. This is worse. Somebody gave me advice yesterday, and this was worse than yesterday. Okay. Why are you laughing at?
Translated.
Huh? Translated. Oh, not bad. Okay. So I don't need to say anything. You just wait for translation and you laugh anyway. How nice. Oops. Oops, what is going on? Ah, a better. Your mama is getting older now. This one go to behind then. I asked to a different kind of glass, but that's what they bought for me. I asked for some kind different one, yeah? The one that can open from the front and then cluck. Like that. And then they buy the one that open from the back and open from the front and open nowhere. No, nothing open. Okay, now. This is a story about a nun named Viyu. Viyu means very wonderful. Hmm? Wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful Bichuni means nun wonderful. Wonderful nun is her name. Her name I translate as wonderful. Okay? Yeah. This is from Anand again. Nah? Yeah, we have to thank the Buddha and Anand for all this beautiful story. Thus I have heard. One time the Buddha was in the country Save at the ashram Kihuan. After the king of that country died, his crown prince name like a diamond, came to the throne and ruled the country. But this man is very bad. This prince is very bad. He's not as good as his father. Yeah. He's very, very violent, greedy, and very, very impossible. Yeah. Many times he let his elephant came out to the city outside and stamp on a lot of citizens and make them die a lot. At this time, many of the nobles and rich families' daughters, they felt very, very, very fed up and tired of this kind of treatment of the king. So every one of them, many of them, came to the Buddhas and became nun together. Yeah. A lot of them. Hmm. The citizen at that time saw that many of these girls whose family are noble and rich and, you know, has good position and comfortable house, they all went to become nuns. Yeah, either some of them they like, or some of them they respect because of such a good family's daughters. Yeah, and they forsake everything just to become a renunciate. So many citizens, you know, they came and make offering a lot, yeah, to them. One time, they talked to each other like this. Although we have become nuns, and even though we have the title of Bichuni, meaning reverend nuns, you know, high level, high priestess, yes. But concerning the Buddha's teaching, we didn't really understand a lot, yeah. So we has not been able to drink the Buddha's ambrosia, you know, the nectar, meaning the teaching, the highest teaching, the one that you can feel it, you can have experience with, you know, like initiation. Perhaps they have not been initiated. Therefore, many of our karma has not been destroyed. Only initiation can destroy past karma. Understand? Only the Buddha initiate them, then they can destroy many aeons of karma. Often like that. In many stories before, they always say that whenever they got in front of the Buddha after he preaching, and then a special, and then many aeons of karma has been annihilated, yes, nullified. Now they were thinking that their, sensual desire and anger and arrogance from times immemorial has not been completely annihilated, nullified. So they think, they talk to each other. They say, okay, now I think we have to go to the Talananda, great superior mother, nun. Just like superior mother in Catholic, okay? So that we can study with her, and then she will give us some of the better teaching. For example, like the eight kind of respect. That is the Buddha when he first accept his mother as a nun. No, not mother, but like a stepmother. His mother died at birth, you remember, I told you. And then his the sister of his mother took care of him, because he was just a born baby. Therefore, he also is also his mother, And then after the Buddha became Buddha and have many monks and monks follow him already and lay people follow him already, she also came, and Rahula also became a monk. Rahula is his son, his only son, also became a monk. So she also came to ask the Buddha to become a nun. But at that time there was no nun anywhere. And then the Buddha said, cannot. Mostly the renunciate order is only for monks. It's not convenient for women to become monks with them. There was no such thing before. And then so after she insisted, and then Anan was talking in interfere on her behalf, begging the Buddha, saying that she has taken care of you since you were a baby. Without her, you probably would not be able to survive or live as well. So she is your mother, and you cannot deny her request. Something like that, understand? Because this is not like a worldly request, but it's a noble intention. So you must accept her. Then the Buddha relent and accepted her as a nun. But before that, he make eight rules for her to follow. If she can follow it and accept it, then she can become a nun. Okay? I have to confess, I don't remember all of the eight. But it's almost like you have to bow, have to prostrate to the monks, no matter how young that monks is, always. One of us is like that, If she can accept it, then she can become a nun, And many others, probably, but the nuns have also about 200-something other precepts, almost like the monk. It just modified a little bit for nuns, The Buddha thinks, not because he didn't want, but he was worried, number one, she is from royal household, royal blood. And she has been used to with luxurious life and have servants, always at her beck and call. And then she's always ordering, she's used to with this kind of, matriarch-like life, She cannot, he worries she cannot humble herself to live as a monk. A monk's life, only one meal a day at that time, except when you're sick or something special, or when you go on different journey, then maybe you don't have food for another long time, so you can eat any other time. Otherwise, you have to eat only at noon. yeah. And then have to live ascetic life, you know. Cannot have a high bed and a lot of beautiful clothes, anything like that. Probably one of the rules are like that, okay? Can she accept this kind of ascetic life, you see? Like living anywhere, sleeping under the tree or on the grass, on dry grass or in the cave, you know, with grass cover, thing like that. Above all, have to respect all the monks, regardless of age. For example, yeah, like that. If she can accept all this, then she can be nun. She accepted everything. Obedience to monks as well, you know, because the Buddha warrior also, she come here and, you know, I'm the mother of the Buddha and I'm the queen, you know what I mean? Then all the monks has to respect her and all that stuff, yeah? And she might order the monks to do things for her just like in the palace. And then what to do, you see? So the Buddha has to make the rules like that. She accepted everything. And she lived also an ascetic life like everyone else. Then it was okay. After that, she became a nun, and she's the first one in his order, yes. After a while, there are more, yeah? There are more, yes. Now we come back to this, these nobles' families' daughters. There were about 500 people, 500 daughters of good families have become renunciate. But at that time, maybe they just became renunciate by themselves. You know, they did not even come to the Buddha yet. So this time, they think they should go to one of the Buddha's nun's disciple, yeah, to learn things from her. Because any nuns came in, the Buddha will refer it to the nuns to teach them. The Buddha will not teach them directly himself. Yes, he might give initiation and all that, but they don't live together with the monks. Okay, they live separately, and he asked one of his eldest nun or his stepmother to teach them every necessary rules and precept and all that. Yeah. So that right now they think they have not, these are 500 daughters of good household, they didn't think they have enough precepts or ideas about the Buddha's teaching or anything. Therefore they think they should go to study with this nun. Yeah, okay. So now they all came to see this elderly nun, yeah, the mother superior, yeah, well, we can call that, and they prostrated in front of her and requested, saying, respected reverend mother, yeah, we younger children, yes, do not know what kind of merit we have. That's in the past life, that in this lifetime we even have a fortune to know about the Buddha and then can become even renunciates, yeah? Yeah, and even became high priest, yeah, high nuns. But even though we have become a high priestess, we have not really understood a lot about Buddha's teaching, yeah. So today, all of us, 500 young nuns, children come here begging you to be merciful and give us some teaching. Yeah. So that we can gain more merit. Yeah. And receive the blessing from the Buddhas and from you. Yeah. So the Tolananda Bichuni, meaning the high priestess, yeah? Mm. They also Bichuni, but she's the elder one, senior, yeah. She said to them, all of you have been born in a good, rich, noble family. Mm. Most of you came from a long line of noble lineage and richer lineage, but You never lack anything in your life, and even in such a young age, in such a beautiful age like yourself, and then you wanted to become a nun. Why should you do that? Why would you do that? Shouldn't. Never mind. Don't do this. It's a wasting of your youth. It's useless. Just give me all this nuns drop and nuns bowls, you know, baking bowl. Give it to me and go home. Yeah, marry, enjoy the life of comfort and luxury. Yeah. Why, you know, it's a pity if you became a nun and stay in some of the, you know, remote area, have nobody to talk to, and loneliness, and it's like you bury yourself under cold ashes, you know, wasting your life. Just go home. Uh-huh. After all of them heard this high Bichuni told them like that, they feel very confused and desolated, and they were crying, and they prostrate to her and then left. And then when they went out, they talked to each other. They say, we are the ones who want to escape from these worldly bindings of you know, marriage and sensual love, and you know, and family life, and to escape from ignorance, you know, to liberate ourselves from all kind of mundane bother, mundane trouble, and binding, and affliction, and all kind of trouble in this worldly life. And now we came to her. Not only she did not give us any good advice or any teaching, she even talk like that. Want to drag her back into the mud, yeah, where we don't want to stay, yeah, where we already feel that is nothing for us anymore. That's why we left. Yeah, look like she want to drag us back into the tiger's dens, on the mouth of the lions, you know, to ruin our lives, yeah, ruin our aspiration and ideal. I think this is no good. Yeah, she want us to be life after life transmigrated in lowly level of consciousness and getting nowhere in the spiritual elevation or enlightenment. Okay, I think all of us should go to another Bichuni, another nuns, another high priest. Her name is Vihyu. Vihyu, I thought a wonderful nun. Yeah, this is another one. Yeah, and then we will beg her to help us. Yeah, to save us. Okay, talked and done. They went there. Oh God, they prostrate, you know, flat on the ground. Almost, utmost, with utmost reverence, and tell her, reverence, great priestess, you know, mean nuns, yeah. At home, we don't know what to practice. We are deep in ignorance, and we've done many things that is not really virtues or moral, nothing good for anyone or nothing good for us. And now, even though we have renounced our worldly life, but our heart inside, our mind, our heart is still feeling full of greed and, you know, greedy for or desires for sensual pleasure. And many times, often, our sensual desire is still very strong. It just comes out of nowhere. And we cannot control. They're young, you know, the hormone. The hormone. Hormone is a trouble. But even then, at least they know how to run away from it, huh? Yeah, many people just run with it. Okay. They confess, you know, they're confessing that even though they became a nun, but they have not been able to control their desires and all kind of stuff, yeah. Advise us something, teach us something, so that we can be able to control that. So that we'll be able to liberate ourselves from all this binding of the physical desire. From this karma of desire. So the Bichuni, wonderful, said to them. There were three lifetime, the past, the present, and the future. Which one would you like to ask about? So they say, Reverence Bichuni, the past and the future is far away. Yes, we don't dare to ask. We only want to ask about this present life. Like the karma that binding us in this kind of sexual desire, you know, from the bodily longing for sensual pleasure, that is torturing us in this lifetime, that we could not control, that we don't even know where it comes from, and it's just kind of pressuring on us, oppressing us. Please tell us, is it bad or is it good? Is it beneficial or is it harmful to us? What kind of a consequence it will bring us? Yeah, if we follow this kind of path of sensual desire, yeah, and whether it will bring us any good benefit in the future or not. Please explain all this to us. Yeah. So the Bichuni, wonderful, said to them, if you all want to know, please listen carefully. Yeah. And they say, yes, Reverence Bichuni, we will. We will pay all attention to your advice. So the Bichuni said, all of you should know. Yeah, all the things that exist, either in heaven or in earth, everything that has form, either invisible form or visible form, you understand? The heavenly being, they have form, but for us, we don't see, but they still have form. Yeah, so anything that has form and life, it is born out of a sensual desire. Yeah, and sensual pleasure, yeah. Sexual desire is comparable to a big fire, yeah, that is always burning within beings. And this fire could, it's so violent, it could even burn away forests and trees and grasses and even stones and even the whole immense universe. Whew, incredible. I never heard anyone say such like that. Okay. Anyone who has been captured tightly within this sexual desire is as if the enemies is already in your house. They're going to destroy your house, destroy your life. And this person, if indulging and following that desire, will definitely will be, how you say, will be born but exiled into these three wicked path. It's very doesn't know when they can escape. There is no time that they can escape. No schedule time that they can escape. These are three bad paths, the three evil paths. This is, you remember? What? The hell, yeah? And the ghost, and also animals. It's very difficult for them to be born as human, even unless they are good, even their family, but they practice, they keep the five precepts or the 10 good ways. So now, anyone who are attached to their house, their possession, and their family, it's because they love this kind of unified gathering. And, you know, happiness with the unified gathering. And because of that, because of this, it's they will give, their life will be given in to, being born again and getting old, getting sick, and then die in this kind of circle. They will not get out of that circle. And then they will have to also suffer, separation, either through life or through death. And sometimes in the middle of their love, on the peak of their love life, they have to separate because of something happened in life or something happened that they die, one of them die. You know, all kind of very suffering, pain, you know, mental, emotional, physical. If they continue to be attached in this kind of, to be too attached in this kind of family and union, sensual pleasure. Some people are so much attached to the love of their life or the other opposite sex that if they cannot satisfy this love, their heart is like burning and their mind is being so like imprisoned. It's very, very difficult, to get out of that. Like lovesick, you know? As if somebody binding their mind and tightening their heart and breaking their feeling and all kind of suffering. I myself, the nun, wonderful, she's talking about her life now. I myself was born in a Brahman family. Brahman is a top caste in India for caste system. My father was the most revered, respected in the whole country. At that time, you know, when she was younger, there was a noble and rich family also in the Brahmin caste. Has a very good-looking boy and also very intelligent. Because they know that I am also good, you know, beautiful. She was saying like that. I was also beautiful, and they saw me beautiful, and also from the good family, noble family, and same caste. So they came and asked for my hand for their son. After we married, and we have given birth to one son. Because long time I haven't seen my parents, so I miss them very much. So I ask, how come she says she has a son yet? And now she says she missed her parents. She wants to go home to see their parents because she missed her parents so much. But now she says that at that time she was still pregnant. In her pregnancy, she worried about life is not predictable. Life and death is unpredictable. She asked Therefore, she asked her, she asked her husband to let her go home, yeah, to see the parents. She worried that maybe when she have birth and she might die or something, yeah, she would like to see the parents in case, yeah, like that. Okay, my husband allowed me to go home. She also, he also came with her, according to this, yeah. And both, both of them, you know, take their luggage and bring their son. Yeah. Oh, so at that when she was pregnant, she asked. She, I don't know. Now, probably she asked when she was pregnant, but now already gave birth to the kid. Yeah, and then they took their son together, go back to see the wife family. Yeah, in the they are walking only halfway, and then it's dark. Became dark. They came. They went out in the morning, and went into the dark. It's about halfway, and then both of them, husband and wife, were resting under a tree, you know, to sleep at night. But in the midnight, she suddenly she has her stomach problem. You know, she has, I don't know, a period or something problem, and then she bleed. She bled, yeah. And many of the poisonous snakes and other insects, they smell the blood. So they came there. They came to visit both of them. But they didn't bite her. They bit the husband dead. Yeah. When he's sleeping, they beat him up. They bite him, beat him, and then he's died. He's dead. I keep calling him. He did not answer. So in the morning, I hold his hand to try to pull him standing up. And then I feel that his hand is so cold, ice cold. And then the whole body was so rigid. It's like a piece of wood. Then after that, I check out and I knew that he has been bitten by poisonous snake and already passed away. And of course, I lamented heaven and earth. And then I collapsed, fainted for a long time. My child keep crying for me. And then slowly I regain my consciousness. And then I have to carry my boy to go further, yeah. As I enter one of the very desolated street, there was a big river, yeah. But there's no, the water is not too deep. There's no boat. So, oh. Oh, okay. Now I understand. First she gave birth to one son, and then she's pregnant again, according to that now, yeah. So that she has two children, yeah. So, okay, so because there is no boat, so she carry one child first to the other side, so that she will come back later to get the other one. But unfortunately, this little boy fell down in the river and drowned. And then I could not find my child, yeah? And when I returned to the other child, unfortunately, the tiger already took him. What terrible misfortune, huh? Husband died, and then one child died, and then another child drowned like that. This is a terrible life. But it could happen. It could happen to anybody. Today I watch the terrible news about refugees, particularly from Syria, you know. And then there's another. There's one family. The husband went out to another country to become refugees, wanting to make a better life for their family, his family at home. But then, I don't know, his family somehow died from the sea. Their body are washed to the shore. One baby, one little boy, 3 years old, his brother and the mother. And the husband has to go back to the city where they wanted to flee in order to bury three of them. And many refugees are, you know, streaming into Europe right now. Many European countries are trying to cope with it. And they even walk, you know, like in Hungary, the police tried to stop them and put them in I don't know why they stopped them. They were staying together in the train station. Had no food, no water, nothing, just rely on some people, private, come and give them something. Then the police don't let them board the train to go to Austria or Germany. They want to go to Germany. They think German people will welcome them better. But the train will stop going. They don't let the train go. I don't know, for some reason. So they climb the barrier, you know, that the police set up. They climb up with children and babies. They climb up and they go in on the highway. They're walking to Austria border. From Hungary to Austria border is about 150 kilometers, more or less, yeah, or more. They're walking with nothing, just some clothes on their backs and children or people, whoever they can, they walk. It's terrible. I have asked the FG to send some donation to some of the refugee center wherever they accept our donation, but I have not followed up whether they sent or not. Sometimes difficult, you know, we send but people don't accept even. I don't know what have I done. My money is absolutely clean. I did not even harm a fly to earn my money. So I wonder why some organization don't take our money, even though they say they desperately need for the help, to help the refugees and all that, you know? Yeah. It's probably just karma, you know? Yeah, it's karma, yeah. Sometimes they said that if they accepted our money, then other big people will not donate to them anymore. So I wonder why. Have I ever killed any fly? Huh? Yes or no? No. Oh. Have I done anything? Rob the bank or something? No. I earn my own money. Yeah? Clean. I didn't sell drug or I didn't sell anything illegal to make money. Our business are registered and legal. Yeah. Registered with the government and legal. My money is clean. But so what to do? Yeah? We wanted to help only. We didn't want fame or name or anything. We could even donate anonymously, but they don't accept. Some funny, funny concept, huh? Funny mentality. So I'm tell them to send to some of a refugee camp, you know, if they can, yeah. Because we cannot always go into the camp ourselves, but we can send through other organization who's already there, you know. Sometimes some government don't allow everybody to come in the camp, you know, just some already stay there, you know. And we go through them. But if some of them don't accept, then we also have no way to help the refugees at all. No way. So now, okay. And when I went to the other side, the tigers already took my other son away. I only saw some drop of blood on the ground. I was beyond suffering, beyond pain, beyond sorrow. So I fainted for a long time, collapsed on the ground. long, long time, and then I woke up. I became absolutely alone, lonely and confused, and lost all kind of orientation and thinking. I'm just walking, you know, like a body without soul. I'm walking, walking. I didn't even know where I was walking, where I'm going. And then, after a few miles, I met one of my father's friends. Yeah, very good friend of my father. And he asked me, "Where have you been? How come you look so tattered and dirty and, you know, unkempt like this?" So I told him everything, the story of my misfortune. I said that yesterday I and my husband want to visit my parents. And then my husband was bitten dead by the snakes. And then this morning I lost both of the children. One is drowned in the river, the other one is been eaten by tiger. I have no way to tell you my pain. "Oh, really, my God," he said, you know, the best friend of my father's. "Oh, really, how pitiful. You know, yesterday your house has been in a fire accident. All of your family, your parents, your siblings, they all being burned to death. There is no more pain, no more, nothing that can be more painful for you. Nothing really can be more painful for you." He was showing all his sympathy. After I heard that, as if a thunder, you know, as if the blistering thunder is right next to my ears, I fainted again, collapsed on the ground for a long, long time. And then I keep lamenting and crying and lamenting and crying. Yeah. The man, feeling so sorry for me, he took me home and took care of me like his own daughter. After a while, my suffering pain, you know, gradually decreased. In that vicinity, there was a man, yeah, also from Brahmin family. He saw I'm beautiful and asked somebody come to ask for my hand for him. Người mối mai là gì đó thì tiếng Anh nó là gì hả? The matchmaker, yeah, he asked the matchmaker, thank you, to come and ask for my hand. Okay, then I was also lonely and thinking this man also very good, from good family and he look good, so okay, I agree to marry. I close my eyes and let fate decide it this time. Yeah. And I just trying to see how fate will fare me at this time. Okay. And then I was pregnant. Yeah. At that time, it's a labor time, you know? The time of birth. In the middle of the night, I gave birth. Yeah. And then at that time, my husband went out after drinking and eating, or maybe playing a card somewhere, playing games somewhere, come back. And he knocking at the door. Because at that time, I was in labor. I was giving birth at that time and painful. So I have, at that time, the birth, you know, just occurred. I could not get out to open the door on time. He was very angry, broke the door, came in, and beat me up nonstop. I was praying and begging to him and say, "Husband, dear husband, I was having pain because of labor. I want to give birth. It's not like I'm lazy or not respecting you. Please, please. But then he was so angry that he killed the baby born, the just born baby. And then he forced her to eat this baby up. Oh God, what a terrible. Oh my God. But he forced her, he beat her up until she has to do it. And then after that, she felt so terrible, terrible, so repentant. I'm sorry, I didn't know the story is so bad. Should I continue? Or not? Yeah? Huh? Okay. She was feeling so remorseful and so disgusted with herself. She was thinking, what kind of unlucky life I have, that I have to meet this kind of, violent and immoral and wicked person, yeah. So the next morning, I left home. I went to the country called Balanai. I was sitting outside the city wall, and there was one of the men here, one of the son of a noble family, his wife just died. Yeah. Every day he went out to visit the wife's tomb. He saw me crying. So he came and asked me, where did you come from? Why are you sitting here alone and so sad? And then I told him everything about my life. And then he invited me into a restaurant to have a drink. And then after we drink and talk happily, you know, compatibly together, he asked me, if now somebody want to marry you, will you agree? yeah, you know already. So I said to him, dear sir, I'm too tired. Too fed up. It's not really the married life. It's not much happiness in it. Even a little happiness is a short life. And afterwards, it's only suffering and non-stop. Yeah. It's very difficult to find a good-hearted man. Yeah, and then if I meet a wicked person again, it's even more suffering. Mm. So he asked me, so you want to live alone all your life now? Like that? Yeah. He said, no. I said, no. I not really desire to live alone. Just if I find somebody who is gentle, yeah, who is a gentleman and good heart, and then maybe I, and also have moral standard and also educated, then I probably will agree to marry him, yeah. So he said, all right, miss. Okay, I'm not beating the bush any longer. I am the son of the noble family in this city, yeah. The wife just died recently. I saw you, a good woman, yeah, very good-hearted woman. I would like to stay with you for 100 years, meaning marry you. Would you like? Yeah. So I saw him look like a gentle person. Yeah, like a very good person. So I agree to marry him. Unfortunately, after 3 years, he caught some disease and died. Oh my God, what a life. At that time, in this country, if a man lost his wife, like to death, yeah, to death, then he can remarry. But if a wife lost her husband, if a husband died, then the wife must also die with the husband. So buried together in the same tomb. Understand? The wife have to die and be buried together in the same tomb. Oh my God. Buried alive. So therefore, I was also buried together with my husband alive in the same coffin, same tomb. But at that time, I wasn't dead yet. And then that night, there were a band of robbers came and digging the coffin, the tomb and the coffin, to take the jewelries and, you know, all the things that bury with the dead people and her. And then the leader of the robber band saw me beautiful and forced me to be his wife. Oh, God. All right. Not long after. I think you can write the rest of the story. This robber leader, not long after, the government caught him and chop his head. And of course, the subordinate, you know, of the band, caught her and also buried together with the leader husband. Again, yeah. 3 days after, many tigers came to the, because of the chopped head, you know? There's a smell of the blood still there. So some of the tigers, this I explained here, they didn't explain it here, but I just tell you why. They came and dig out the tomb and tried to eat the flesh. Yeah. And they wanted to eat them, or eat her also. But then suddenly already is a daytime. And many people come walking by to go to the market. So they scare. A lot of people, so they scare, they run away. Therefore, I try to dig the earth and get out. I did get out. But I sat there next to the tomb and cry again. My God, what a life, huh? Okay. She was crying to herself, thinking, I don't know what kind of terrible deeds I have done in the former life. That's in this lifetime, I had to encounter so many disaster, pain, sorrow, and suffering, thirst. Yeah. How many times I almost die and live again and come back and to life and die again and come back to life again. How terrible. And I observed that properly, you know, hundreds, thousands, or millions other same female sex like me, also married, and I think this is all like a yoke, you know, on the female's life, like imprisonment, yeah. Is only slavery, yeah, and making your life more and more ignorant and suffer. Because we don't know a better life. We don't know. We don't recognize a more noble way of life, a better path to go. We do not know how to step up onto the true path to liberation and the true path to know the reality, yeah, the another higher than this physical life, so that we will not be able to be free from this mundane prison. Yeah, it is because of the ignorance and all kind of sensual desires that make us slave, lead us into slavery. Yeah. And when you already realize that this terrible truth of human life, of being a housewife life, then it's too late. As if we are always being being dragged again and again into this kind of into the kind of traps of sensual pleasure and greed and lust for fame, you know, and fortune and happiness, which is a delusion, delusive and elusive happiness. Yeah. Therefore, we will have been and will be always transmigrating into this circle of life and death and suffering forever. Yeah. Now I just suddenly remember when she was crying like that, then she suddenly remembered that one time there was a person from the family of Seka, I mean the Buddha, yeah. He has become a monk, you know, renounced the world to practice the truth. And now he has already attained Buddhahood. Okay, I think now I should go to him to take refuge in him so that I can escape suffering. Yeah, so I got up, keep walking, but my body is full of pain. And my stomach is also very, very hungry and thirsty. And it's a long, long way to where the Buddha is, and it was a very dangerous way, you know, dangerous journey for a woman alone, you know, hungry, thirsty. But I do not mind. I did not mind. I was determined to go to find the Buddha, to liberate me, to help me. I keep walking and asking the way until I found myself. I found myself in the forest of Kihuan. Yeah, at that time it's already dark. You know, the night fell, but long from long way I have seen the Buddha already. I have seen him bright as a mountain of gold, yeah, a very dignified, very majestic, but full of compassion and mercy. He is truly an extraordinary being. He's not from this world. Yes, he's definitely able to liberate heaven beings as well as human beings. So at that time, I was beyond joy, and I knelt down, you know, on the road, and looking toward his direction, and pray to be liberated. And then the Buddha came to me. At that time, I was kneeling on the ground. My body has nothing to cover. I feel so ashamed. I have to try to cover myself with my hands. Yeah. The Buddha asked Anand, a reverend, to bring me a clothes to wear, a piece of a clothes. And then I went to the Buddha and prostrate at his feet and then tell him everything about my life up to now, and beg him to let me become his nun-disciple. Yeah. And then the Buddha asked Anand to bring me to the nun, great compassionate way, that's her name. I translate it like that, to teach me. Yeah. And then she give me the bhikkhuni, the nun's precepts, yeah, and make me become a priestess. And then she teach me the Four Noble Truths, yeah, how to escape suffering and birth and death, transmigration and all that. Yes, I was very diligent in my practice and keeping my precepts as a nun. Not very long, I truly understand, truly realized that life is truly a suffering, and the Buddha's teaching and the enlightened saint's teaching is truly a path to liberation. And then I could even understood my past lives, and I can see my future life. And I can see what kind of bad deeds, what kind of wicked deeds I have done in the past lives. So that in this lifetime, I have to bear the consequences. So some of the new nuns asked the Bhikkhu, wonderful, Bhikkhuni, wonderful, Reverence Mother, in the past life, what kind of, you know, sin did you commit it, so that in this lifetime you suffer so much? Please, can you tell us, so that we can learn something? So they say, yes, I will tell you. Pay attention. And they say, yes, we will. Long life ago, my long time ago, at that time, long many lifetime ago, long time ago in the past, at that time there was a noble, rich family, has no children, yeah. Has no children with the first wife, so he married a concubine, the second wife, yeah. And this concubine, this wife is very beautiful. The second wife is very beautiful. So he really favors her very much. She is his favorite. Yeah. And both of them are loving each other passionately. Life is good. Love is great. Yeah. And not long ago, she gave birth to a son even. Oh, God, it's even more favorite. You must know, you should know in the old time, even now, giving birth to a son. For example, even now in China, give birth to a son meaning good. Give birth to a woman, no. We are still second-class citizen, okay? Because a man can carry the family's tradition and business and name, you see? So that means the family name will live longer, continue. Mm. But the woman born have to be married far away from home and take the name of the husband. And whatever children born, it will be the name of the stranger over there. Understand? Nothing to do with wife family anymore. For example, like that. Yeah. Therefore, since then, he even loved her more and more and more. You know, anything she wants, is immediately she gets, yeah, like that. And then the first wife was thinking to herself, oh, since I marry him, we both work very hard together, husband and wife, and sparing, you know, and saving in order to become rich like today. Mm. Hey, but now in the future, I'm sure only the second wife will have it all. Yeah. It is so useless for me. I will have nothing. Wasted all my time and my youth. Now working hard for somebody else to enjoy. Yeah. I think it's better I kill her, the second wife. She was thinking like that. So she used a very long needle. Yeah, long needle. Wait until everybody sleeps, she came and thrust the needle in the baby's head and killed him. Not immediately, but after a few days, the baby died. Yeah. And of course, the second wife, crying day and night, you know, nonstop. And then after a while, she was thinking, my son was not sick, nothing wrong with him. Suddenly, he died like that. I think his first wife killed him. And then she came and confronted the first wife and asked her, my son has done no harm to you. What sin has he done that you kill him like that? And of course the first wife said, what are you talking about? Huh? Why are you talking crazily like that? I swear, yeah, if I kill your son, then life after life, my husband will be beaten dead by snakes. And if I have sons, if I have children, then either they drown or the tiger will eat them. Or the wolf will eat them up. Or I will be buried and myself will be buried alive. And I will eat up my own children. And then all my family will be burned in fire to death. Yeah. Everything happened, as she said, as you knew already from the story. Okay. So all of you should know. The first wife of that noble, rich family man, that life was me. Because I did not know about the karma and the consequences of karma. Therefore, I was wickedly killed the baby son, and I swear as if nothing will happen. Therefore, in this lifetime, I had to suffer that much, as exactly as what I have wished in my oath. Yeah, in my terrible oath, because I didn't believe that this anything could happen. Yeah. Okay. So the five new nuns asked her again, Reverend Mother, but what kind of good deed have you done in the former life, so that in this lifetime you are fortunate to meet the Buddha and even attain, you know, liberating a level of consciousness? Could you please tell us? So she said, yes, pay attention. Long time ago, in the country called Balanai, yeah, probably this country is continuously for many lifetimes, eh? Just like, I don't know, Vietnam or France, or, you know, it's always the same name. There's another country, this is the same country, Balanai. Always this country pop up in many stories, yeah. Because this story probably happened in India, you know? A lot of story happened in India. And the same earth. Mm. So that means our earth exists long time ago. And humans has existed long time, aeons ago, before us. And maybe the planet was destroyed or uninhabitable, as like the Mars right now, for example, like that, yeah? And then we revive again, some humans survive somewhere and then regroup and rebirth and, you know, resource again, eh? Yeah, make country again, make human again, make babies again, and life boom again, bloom again, yeah. There was in that country, Balanai, there was a mountain, yeah. Named Fairy Mountain, yeah, or Heaven Mountain, yes. In that mountain and forest, there are many of Pratekya Buddhas, and many lesser saints, and many of others, saintly beings, yeah. Even though not Buddha, but also practice there, and saintly people, yes. At that time, there was a Pratekya Buddha who went in the city begging for food. Yes, and there was a lady from a noble family. Yes, very happily making offering to this Pratekya Buddha.
Yes.
After, because of her sincerity and happiness, you know, truly sincere to make offer to him, he saw his real status. So he fly in the sky and demonstrate 18 of his magical power for her to see.
Yeah.
Because of that, she was so awed, and then she kneeled down on the ground and looking up to him and praised thus, "I prostrate in front of the great reverence, saint, please, in the future, help me to be able to attain such a spiritual level as you are." Yeah, such a spiritual as you are right now.
Yes.
You all should know that a noble family lady, noble and rich, you know, family lady at that time, it was one of my incarnation.
Yeah.
Because I was so sincere and respectfully make offering to this saintly beings, and then I vow, you know, I pray to become to attain a high spiritual level like he did. Therefore, today I have this opportunity to meet the Buddha and attain arhat.
For woman, that's very good, huh?
Even though now I already attained sainthood, but my body is still having pain and ache very, very frequently. You know, from my head until my toe, as if a needle has been, you know, has been picked into my, you know, thrust into my head, from my head to my foot. It's painfully, as if that needle even went through my bones. You see that? She's saying to them, you see that? Yeah. Even the sin, no matter how long, how immeasurable time passed, you still had to bear it. Even then, I'm already an arhat. You know? There are two different things. Merit, you can enjoy. But sin, you must still pay. Endure.
Yes, that's what it is.
Because nothing done, nothing has been done will be erased or deleted. Never. 500 young bhikkhuni, young nuns, hearing thus, everybody shaken with fear, tremble. And then they observe within themselves about the root of sexual desire and sensual pleasure and worldly greed and, you know, longing for worldly satisfaction, as if it's a big bonfire. And then suddenly all their desire for sensual pleasure and worldly attainment finished. Cut off, yeah. And then they observe all the suffering, all the mundane pleasure or suffering is as if it's a prisoner, as it's a prison. Therefore, their karma also cut off. And then in their heart, in their mind, everything is clear.
Yeah.
They understood the truth, the true insight. Yeah? Maybe she initiated them. Yeah, and they see the light. They saw the light. And then they became arhat immediately over there, because there's such a shaken fear within them. Understand? Therefore, they concentrated, the mind cannot disturb them anymore. So fearful of all these consequences from bad karma, that they, their mind became still, so they can focus, yeah, on the initiation time. Maybe that's why they became arhat. Destroy all many, many lifetime, many aeons of karmic hindrance and retributions. After they came out of samadhi, so that means during initiation, eh? I sit there and and meditate, and then become arhat. After they came out of samadhi, they told the wonderful priestess like this, reverence mother, yeah. All of us has been, bounded, you know, and tortured by this sensual pleasure desires. Up to now, we can never shake it off. We could not escape from it until now. Today, relying on your blessing and grace, we have been liberated from them. We have no way to thank you. Yeah, we are so grateful, so grateful. After the Buddha know that, the Buddha was very happy. the Buddha right now, of course he knew anyway. So he praised a wonderful nun like this. Excellent, precious, precious. The nun, wonderful, could preach in such a way as, to benefit herself and then benefit others. Yeah, you are truly the disciples of the three times Buddha, meaning the past Buddhas, the present Buddha, and the future Buddha. That's a high price, very high praise, yeah. And then all these 500 nuns, new nuns, as well at all the assembly, bow and went home. Not went home, but just, you know, retreat. Probably they will stay with the nun and everybody else went home. Mm. Okay. All right then, the story finished. We thank the Buddha, huh? Mm. Wow. What a story, huh? You guys okay? Shaking with fear or not? No? Yes or no? Yes, huh? In the heart, huh? Feel shaky, huh? Yeah. Who wouldn't, huh? Yeah. Even many, many eons passed, many lifetime passed already. Just one time, kill one baby. Became a heart already. All repentant, remorse. Suffer so much already. Still had to bear that consequence. Nothing we can escape free. Therefore, really, karma really exists. Yes. Even become arhat. Yeah. Some karma will be destroyed, but some will remain so that you can continue to live on. Understand? Yeah? For example, we make many bad things. We did many sins in many, 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 many uncountable lifetime. In this lifetime, come back, be reborn as human, suffer some, but some are still in store waiting. Okay? Because in one lifetime, you cannot suffer much more than, you know, like the nun had done. You see, there is a time span for everything. So in one lifetime is short, so you will be allotted how much karma for one lifetime. Then suppose you come back again, then there is a next stored karma will come for you. If without karma you cannot exist here, you're probably in heaven, okay? Or in hell, somewhere else, a different karma then. Huh? Therefore, the nun, luckily she came and took refuge in the Buddha, and she became arhat. And at the time that the Buddha accepted her and initiated her, he will destroy all the stored karma, understand? So that she will not be born again to suffer any. Yeah.
But even then, the fixed karma for this lifetime, she has to bear, even after become arhat already, because that's her fixed karma. Without this karma, she cannot live here. All of us, same, okay? Yeah. Except the master, who has to borrow karma from everybody. Not borrow, but have to come to bear everybody else's karma. Therefore, the master will not suffer any karma, because all done, you know? The Buddha already had no more karma. Yeah. But he still had to suffer here and there because of karma of disciple. Understand? Yeah. All right. Okay then, huh? Good. Yeah. I don't know what kind of karma that I have. My knee is so painful. Yeah. It's old age karma. Okay. Get up, go walking. All right, huh? Any question concerning story, karma, merit, good deed, bad deed? Hmm? No? Hmm. We are going to cover the balcony. Yeah, I told them to cover so at night you're warmer. Is it very cold at night? If you have no question, I have question. You cold? At night? Not yet? Well, thank God the weather is still good, huh? Well, you feel pain or anything because of coldness? Nothing? Yes? No? Okay. It's good. It's good. It's good. But I think it's going to be colder soon. Yes. And at night it might change temperature quickly, or rain or something. So we're going to cover the balcony quickly. Yeah, so the wind don't blow into where you sit. And in daytime, you take turn to roll it back, roll it in one side, you know. The balcony is like this, yeah, we cover it all, if we can do it tonight, if not tomorrow. And in the morning, you just bind it easy to take, not difficult. You bind it easy knot, understand? Just like this, you know? Yeah. So when you want to take it, just like that, okay? Okay. And then in the morning, you take turn whoever likes. You can, when people eat breakfast, yeah, nobody there, and you can just roll it and put it in one side, you know, in the middle, roll it just in some column, you know, put here, and bite it on the balcony so it don't blow up, blow away. And then in the night, you tie it up again. Okay? Yes. In case it rains or in case it's cold, it turn cold. Huh? All right? Yeah. Number one, there's something, the water here is precious. Water everywhere is precious. We are lucky to live in a country that the government take good care of water. Okay? So we also have to save it. Okay? We use it sparingly, okay? When you go toilet and anything, use sparingly. If you wash your hand and wash in the bucket, and then so that when it enough, you can put in toilet, you know? Yeah. If it's a small business, then you put little water or no need, and then later, if it's big business, then you throw a big bucket inside, okay? So don't keep flushing, yeah? Because the water even it's not about money or anything. It's more about environment, okay, and convenience for everybody. The if we use a lot of water, then it become more expensive for poorer people. Same with electricity. Understand? The more we use, the more expensive. Yeah, other poor people, or maybe don't have enough for poor people. Understand? So we just save everything at home also, not just here. Yeah, so that everybody has a good share of water, electricity, and necessities. You understand now? Yeah. If you don't use any light anywhere, then you turn it off for me, okay? Standby light, when not necessary, turn it off. At home also. I do the same. I do the same. Sometimes, like something like a telephone, yeah? Like a telephone, for example, and you plug it in, after a while, it's fully charged. Then you turn off the standby light. Television also, because like the television, it has standby light, you see?
So if you have a standby light, you turn it off. So the standby light don't light up the whole night. But there's something you don't need to turn off, like the refrigerator, and they're not the thing without the standby light. Then you don't have to put it in standby light to turn off. Put on normal light, normal plug, normal socket, so that the standby light don't light up the whole night, the whole day, and it will cost electricity, understand? Because if you turn off the whole standby in the house, you save at least 10% of the bill. Okay? Mm. And also, the water, there is a filter water in near the kitchen. There's a big machine there. You use it, okay? You ask where it is to use, okay? You don't just drink straight from the tap. Even though the water in here is very good. But just to be sure, okay? Drink filter water or drink the cooked tea. Understand? Mm? Filter water and cooked tea, okay? If you want to drink water, just cook the water. There are some kettle there for you to boil the water to cook, okay? And you just boil enough for use only, okay? And other people will also boil the same. Otherwise, they come, they don't know that you boil water already. The thing is not boiled, so they boil again. The next person boil again and again, okay? Yes. We have to use the pump, different pumps to pump water from the city here. So we have to pump the water here. And a lot of people use every day, all the time. So the pump go kaput so quickly. Like these 2-3 days, we have to keep repairing it. Oh, and now buy new one. But even then, a new one, we also need to take care. So don't have to waste a lot of water. Because the more we use water, the more the pump has to work. The more the pump has to work, the more we have to repair or renew the pump. You know, even we put in a new pump, have to take care. You see, understand? We can do it. We can buy the pumps forever. But the more we save, the better the pump will work longer. The pump will work longer. Your brother and sister who take care of the water and electricity doesn't have to work harder. They came here to meditate. So the less they work, the more they can meditate. Do you understand the consequence of everything, the karma, yeah? In this lifetime, yes? Okay? So have mercy on your brothers who take care of water. Use sparingly. Save as much water as you can. I'm not restricted you. I'm not restricting you. I'm just talking logic, okay? All right? Yeah. They're very good, efficient. They're willing to work. But we must save it so they don't have to work too hard. So they have more time to meditate and enjoy their retreat like everybody else. Do you understand now?
Yes.
Yes. It's not just about money. Time is about everything, okay? Yeah, we must know that. And at home also consider that, okay? Because also the more we use water, the more the government had to work on water. Because the water don't come straight to us from the river or lake. They have to treat the water with some chemical, okay? Have to have people to take care of water, protect the water, test the water every day for us, and use machine and all that to pump water in all directions, understand? So if we use less, then they have to take care less, and they like, use less chemical, less treatment. Understand this? So everything connected with each other. Hmm? Even if we can afford it. I can afford it. It's just we must be careful about how we use everything on this planet. Yeah? It's a common property, even though you pay for it. But water belongs to common property, belongs to everybody on this planet. Actually, it's like that. Just unfortunately, our world has not organized enough so that everybody has a good share of water. And because of water, many wars broke out, you know? Yeah, they sometimes they warring with each other because they want to get the position where the water is. Yeah? And because not enough water, people have to go far away or have to fight for water as well. It's very important to have water, that's why. You see, I hope in the future that many governments, leaders will sit together and plan of the way how to distribute more water for different areas. You know, many people, many children have to drink unclean water or poison water because they have no choice.
So here we have fortune to drink good water. Yes, we should be, you know, treasuring it and, you know, taking care of it as much as we can. Okay? That's all. Okay? Right. Yeah. Water, electricity is a fortune for us that we have. Many countries, many areas don't have electricity, don't have water. Remember that, okay? And even many refugees come, they're short of water, short of many things. We are very fortunate. So we try to treasure and take care, okay, huh? Everybody understand? Yeah, very good. I was thinking I'd say something else, but I forgot. Oh. And you wash your hand in the sink, even you have the sink, but you put a bucket, small bucket, and so your water will come into the bucket. And then you bring it and put it into the big bucket, or in the toilet bucket, and put the empty bucket back under the sink faucet, so that when whatever you wash, it go in there, and then we use it for different thing, okay? The toilet or everything, yes. Especially summer water sometimes is more shortage than usual. And nowadays, many of glaciers has melted, so the water is getting more and more precious all the time because of climate change as well. Understand, yeah? Yeah. Okay. All right, then. I wish you a good meditation night and a good rest. Yeah? Okay? I also will come in and I'll meditate with you, and then I have to come out, take care of other business and take care of my dogs and my family. I'm responsible for them. Now they're older and, you know, not well, I have to take care also. But luckily, I have some people also take care of the dogs. Otherwise, I have no time to sit here with you. You know, they're older, they need medicaments, they need feeding, they need taking care, go in and out and all that, you know, cleaning. And so I'm also grateful that somebody taking care, okay? Yes, but even then, I have other work to do, many, many work. So I come in and now I cannot sit with you all day, okay? I come sit whenever I can. I sit most of the time with you, many times, right? I come in and I sit, and then after a while I had to go do something. So you enjoy, okay? I saw many of you enjoy. You know, really was in Samadhi. I was happy for you. And if somebody come around and touch your head, it could be me only. Nobody else dare do it, so... So don't try to beat me or or hit me or kick me, okay? I'm fragile, all right? Don't kung fu me, huh? Otherwise, I'm so scared I don't come touch you again. Yeah, you always want me to touch your head and your wisdom eye, then that's why I do it. So don't kick me, huh? Huh? I always try to be gentle, but I'm very gentle already. You know, first I touch a little of the hair, and then I go down to the wisdom eye, but somebody's still kung fu me now. Okay, it's okay. Huh? Ah, you're welcome. Okay, take care of each other, huh? The one who came earlier, they teach the new one how to go around, okay? All right. And don't try to stare at me whenever I go out. Be natural, okay? I know you like to see me, but I'm very uncomfortable. I always try to talk to somebody, and then somebody else wants to jump in because I'm talking to that guy, so he also wants to talk. I'm talking about work. Yeah, and if you interrupt, I might forget what I was saying. Okay? Or the person might not understand what I was saying, and then... You'll be in trouble. Understand? Whatever I do here, I talk here, it's just for everybody, okay? Mm-hmm. Don't think I have any private conversation, nothing. Don't try to come in and have a look or stare at me. Very uncomfortable. Understand? Yeah. If I'm talking to somebody, don't try to jump in so he can talk to Master. I also can. Now. Don't be like that, okay? Yeah. You are very big already. Big, 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 old. Some older than me, some less older. You're not children anymore. No. Don't always ask for something. Give me. Give me blessed food. Give me this, give me that.
I already blessed the cake. And still want me to give one by one. My God, imagine. I have to also take care of many things. For you here, I have to take care of more things. For you to sit here, understand? To sit here, meditate well, I have to run around doing background job. Yeah? So don't keep asking for more. Whatever I can do, I do already. Don't think I don't know what you want. I know. But many of you are so childish.
Mommy, extra ghee by the hand.
Why? Huh? You don't have hand? Huh? You go take it yourself, okay? This is for the people who goes home. Everybody take one only, yeah? We don't have enough people to keep buying the whole supermarket. Okay? Yeah, because people keep coming, and we always have to do shopping. We don't have enough time and manpower. Understand this? We have people to buy, but they also have the limited time. And their physical body also need rest. They work all day already, everybody. Understand? The workers, the shoppers, they have to go out every day in the traffic waiting for you. So whatever we have, be happy with it, okay?
Yeah.
Don't ask for more, okay? They work very hard. Yeah, every day have to go out, do shopping for you, for us. Hmm? You have to be thankful for whatever we have, okay? Huh? Just remind you to be good, that's all, okay? See you soon. You meditate and I come in and I'll meditate some with you also sometime during the night. But of course you don't know it, you're too busy.